scikit-learn, okay, learned a little bit about machine learning. We also learned as to how to how do we create our machine learning programs like k-mean, knn, and others. So there are a lot of algorithms which have not gone through, but you know, but then we had to write huge lines of code, and maybe you, some of you did not understand that as to you know how I came up with this. Also, theoretically, I'm sure you would have understood it, okay? Because I took a lot of time in order to explain that, and if you have not understood it, please ask me again, because I want you to understand the theory part of it. If in the program part you did not understand, I'm sure you'll be able to understand when you just open the code, execute it a couple of times, read through each lines of it, you'll be able to understand the practicals or the code part of it. But if you have understood the base, the logic behind the code, then you'll be able to easily understand the code. So I'm not worried much about that. But if you have not understood the concept behind some of those algorithms, please do ask me, okay? I'll have to repeat myself, because that's the main thing here. Now because I was writing a lot of lines of code, right, 20, 30, 40, some of you would have been like, hey, you know, it's too complicated and I don't want to learn it. But using scikit-learn, I would write the same thing that I wrote yesterday in 20, 30, 40 lines in 4 lines of code. And this might interest you. Okay, let me just go ahead and explain. Let me explain as to what scikit-learn is. Scikit-learn is a very simple and efficient tool for data mining and data analysis. Okay, it's available for everybody and reusable in various contexts. Right? It's like I've been telling you, right? This is the package. Where is that package? Here you go. This is the package. Okay, so basically you need to install scikit-learn. That's the first thing. And it's very simple and efficient tool for learning the data. All you have to do is model.fit, model.predict. It's extremely easy. You know, once I explain, you'll be able to understand. But the thing that you'll not be able to understand from scikit-learn is the logic that goes internally. Okay, that you'll have to understand from outside. Because in scikit-learn, everything has been coded internally. All you have to do is know how to call the functions, and your machine learning problem will be solved. It's available for everybody and reusable in various contexts. It's built on NumPy, SciPy, and Matplotlib. It's open source and commercially available. Okay. Now, feature. The library is focused on modeling data. Some popular groups of models provided by scikit-learn are clustering, cross-validation. I mean, why am I taking you through this? Let me just take you through this, right? Let me open this. You see, there are so many algorithms available, okay, on classification, regression, clustering, model selection, pre-processing, dimensionality, reduction, so on and so forth. There are various types of algorithms which are available. Let's say you want to understand SVM, okay? You just click on SVM support vector machines, and there you go. They'll explain everything line by line, sepal length, sepal width. I mean, this is a very famous flower example, iris flower, which I'm going to explain in some time as well. So, see, it's only clf.fit, clf.predict, that's it. You are done. Okay. So, just go through this. Okay, scikit-learn, it's all in Python again. And this is a very beautiful website. It's like a complete book available online. Just go through this and, you know, you can do wonders with machine learning. So, there you go. Just pull this data and play around with it. I mean, just go through this website, play around with it, and you'll be able to understand. You can also go to GitHub and then find the complete code, okay? So moving on. Classification and regression trees. Now let's use the classification and regression trees Bayesian tree algorithm to model the iris flower set. So yours was, okay, that was random forest, okay. Iris dataset is provided as an example dataset with the library. Okay, the reason why I've chosen Iris dataset here in case of my example is because it comes along with scikit-learn. It's free. It comes along with that. I don't have to import it from anywhere else. So I'm good with that. You know, I'm happy to show you what is already available. The classifier is fit on the data, and then predictions are made on the training data. Now let me open this scikit-learn. Hold. Okay, not this one. Let me open that. So basically, I'm importing data sets, metrics, decision tree classifier, okay, and all from scikit-learn. Basically, I could have done from scikit-learn import star or import sklearn, but then I would have to use each of these differently, and it would have been a little difficult explaining stuff. But right now, it makes my life much more easier if I import them, differently. So let me go to this data set. I mean, what does this data set contain? I'm trying to design a decision tree classifier algorithm, okay? Now, for the first time, it takes a little time in order to load the data set because the IRIS data set is quite huge. So you see this? Now, these are the structure of my IRIS data set, okay? Now let me show you as to what an IRIS is. You see, so this is an iris flower, okay? Now, there are various different types of iris flower called Veronica, Setosa, Versicolor. These are the types of iris flower, okay? I mean, how do I know whether this particular flower is one of those three different categories, right? There are three types of iris flower. Let me quickly make a note of it. Excuse me for the spelling. I don't know whether I've spelled it correct or not. So basically, there are three types of iris flower. This is okay. One is okay. So these are the three types of iris flower. Now, how do I determine? I mean, and all of the iris flower looks like this, okay? How do I know whether a particular iris flower that I've selected is Setosa, Veronica, or Versicolor? So basically, that all depends upon your sepal length, sepal width, petal length, and petal width, okay? Based on that, so sepal length, sepal width, petal length, petal. Okay, so these are the four parameters based on which you'll be able to identify whether a particular flower is of particular type. Okay, let's say for example my sepal length is 1, sepal width is 1, petal length is 1, petal width is 1, and then this is of type Setosa. I'm just giving an example, okay? This is, let's say, 1.5, 2, 2, 1.5. It's again, at the end of the day, some kind of definition, okay? Some biologist would have given this name, and then we are following it. And then let's say 3. I'm just giving an example. I don't know whether whatever I'm typing is correct or it's not correct. I don't know. I'm just saying. So if sepal length is 1, sepal width is 1, petal length is 1, petal width is 1, it becomes Setosa. If it is a different dimension, it becomes Veronica. If it is further different, it becomes Versicolor. Okay. So if you look at this flower, you know, some can be like this, some can be like this. These are all iris flower. Okay. This some can be like this. See, this is iris Setosa, this is Virginica, and this is Versicolor, okay? And that's how, now, the problem here is, based on the data set that I have, okay? So these are the data sets that I have, sepal length, sepal width, petal length, petal width, and this is the output that I have, okay? 0, 1, or 2, Setosa, Versicolor, and Virginica, Okay? That's how my data is organized. For each of this data, right, for each of this data, there is an output here. This is the output. Okay? For the last one, the output is 2. Right? 0, 1, 2, it's just an index. So if I do one thing here, if I just print data set dot data comma data set dot target, okay, now okay, print. So all I'm trying to do is I'm trying to show you how the data looks like. So this is basically the input data, right? It's a huge data, okay? And for the input data, these are all my outputs. Okay, guys? Now, after having done that, okay, what is the type of model that I'm trying to create? I'm trying to create a decision tree classifier. Okay, if you look at my scikit-learn, these are the various packages which are available. If I look at my scikit-learn, there is SVM, nearest neighbors, random forest, SVR, ridge, lasso, k-means. So there are so many algorithms already available here. I just have to click one and you see, let me which one is I'm looking at decision tree. You see this? Regarding decision tree, just go ahead and read it. Okay? From here. I mean if you want to. But then let me explain. They are given in extreme detail as to how decision tree works. Okay? So now moving on. Now, what do I want, which algorithm do I want to use? I want to use decision tree classifier. So I created an object of decision tree classifier by, you know, calling an instance of, creating an instance of an object. Now, when I call this decision tree object, classifier class, I am creating model as an object for that decision tree classifier. Okay? Now, once I do that, the next step would be to fit the data into that model. Okay, now model.fit dataset and source and okay, sorry, data and target, if I give that, or input and label if I give that, you know, it will train the algorithm. Basically then it will know as to what you're trying to do. Okay, so what you have to do while you're fitting the model, you have to pass your data as well as your labels, okay, or the target or the output. So when you say model.fit, your model is trained. Once you do that, you can pass your model.predict with whatever data set that you have, your question data set, and then you will get your output. Okay? It says it's of type 2. Now, model.fit. I can also do a print model and then show you as to what are the options available. But that's not of that consequence. So basically, in that decision tree classifier, right, you have all these options. You have max depth, none, max features. So these are various options. If needed, you can use those or you can just ignore it. Are there any specific characteristics of decision tree that requires as input? So basically, you know, if you have, okay, I get your question. So your input should be in the form of metrics, okay? One is, because this is built by sklearn, right? Generally, if you just talk about your decision tree classifier, you can have any type of input. So basically, inside the bracket of your decision tree classifier, there are various options that you can fill. Let's say, for example, if you have, let me go here. Let's say compute, let's say here, right? Let me take one easier example. Maybe sample leaf one, let me go back here. You see this sample split equal to 2. Basically, all you are saying with this sample split equal to 2 is that you have two types of input. Okay. Basically, one is the input data set, one is the data, and the next is the target. Okay. Likewise, if you want to see for each of these others, all you need to do is just go here and then just find it out. Okay. Just go through this and you'll be able to find out for each of this option what does it mean by each of these. I mean, I gave an example of minimum sample split equal to 2. Minimum sample leaf equal to 1 would be, you know, basically when you're doing this decision, you're just going to one leaf, finding out whether you're getting the proper decision or not, and then moving on to the next leaf and so on. So basically, let me not explain this. I'll just explain to you. Have you seen bubble sort, the sorting techniques, or what's that? It's not bubble sort. Okay, even the indexing in database, right? That's more like a decision tree. Okay, let's say for example, okay, so let me draw this. Okay. I'm not explaining that, Puneet. I'm creating my own example so that maybe you'll be able to understand it better. Okay. So let's say, for example, I have values as, let's say, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Okay, okay. I mean, this the decision tree that you see here is very similar to what I have drawn here. Okay, and this particular algorithm is actually rampantly used in any programming language, in any search algorithm that you see, even in indexing, right? In database, it's mostly decision tree. They call it binary tree there, but at the end of the day, it's just the same. Now, let's say, for example, you're trying to search for 2. Okay? You're trying to search for 2. So what it will do here is, it will first go to this node, okay? And then say whether 2 is greater than 5 or not. Basically, if you look into this decision tree, right? Okay, no, this is the wrong step that I've taken. I mean, it has to be 2 nodes, okay? My bad. Let us not consider this. How do I rub it? Okay, so this is how your tree looks like, tree structure looks like, and okay, now if you're trying to search for 2, you'll see that whether 2 is, you know, which one is nearer to 2. Let's say, for example, you go and search here. I mean, 6 is greater than 5, you don't go this route, right? But 4 is lesser than 5, and it is more near, it's nearer to 2, so you traverse this route. Okay, it's very similar to that binary tree algorithm if you have seen in the past. Once you go here, you check for whether you still have this 2 here. You check, you compare 2 against 4, and then you see that, you know, which one is the lesser of the 2. Now you compare 2 against 3. Okay, you first compare 2 against 4, and then you know that your 2 will be somewhere towards the bottom. And then again you go back here and then say 2, you compare 2 and 3, no, I mean 2 is lesser than 3, so you go on the right hand side. So basically, in a decision tree algorithm, there are 2 things, okay? You have the greater than on this side, you have less than on this side, and this will be, this number which will have something greater than on the left hand side, and on the right hand side it will have lesser than. So basically, if you're looking at something to, it will just compare this with the main number, and then if this is less, it will go on this this side. If I were to have 6, this would have gone onto this side. You know, the searching would have been on the left node rather than on right node. So this way, it will traverse each of the node, making a decision as to whether to traverse on the left hand side or on the right hand side, and then it will finally arrive at a conclusion. So Evernote uses of scikit-learn and pandas. Many companies are using it. Okay, I mean I will not name one: Netflix, Mendeley, Wise, Evernote. So just goes on Spotify, Weber. So there are many more companies. I mean, we have just listed a few who uses your scikit-learn. So I mean, that's not the important thing here. So let's talk about application, right? It's not the companies that we are worried about. It's the application that we care about, right? So application of scikit-learn, it's used for predictive analysis. It's real-time cases like stock market prediction, customer churn, astronomy, etc. are done using scikit-learn. Basically, all machine learning problem can be solved through scikit-learn. And if you have heard about Mahout, if you have gone through big data programming, if you have learned big data programming and a little bit of machine learning using big data, you must have heard about Mahout. There are much more algorithms in scikit-learn than Mahout. Okay, facial and handwritten recognition system, you saw this example yesterday, right? Again, that can be used via scikit-learn. You have text classification. Your spam detection, you can do this via scikit-learn. Okay, you have drug response, customer segmentation. If you remember this house prediction problem, or even whether I should give a credit to a particular customer or not, that's customer segmentation. That can also be done using scikit-learn. Now, okay. Now activity, there is one activity that, let me quickly talk about this, and you know what an IRIS dataset is. I just explained to you as to how the IRIS dataset looks like. So this is like sepal length, sepal width, petal length, and petal width, okay? And you have minimum, maximum, mean, and standard deviation. So basically sepal length, sepal width, petal length, petal width, and 0 is setosa, one is versicolor, and 2 is virginica. These are the data that I have. It's exactly the same data that I explained to you over here. And then we will now plot a k-means clustering using scikit-learn. Okay, you have seen what a k-mean is, right? You know the logic behind k-mean. You also know the logic behind KNN. But let's explore k-mean right now. So we'll plot using 3 clusters. We'll also plot using 8 clusters. We'll plot using 3 clusters. And then the initialization factor is just 1, which means that I will be stopping the loop after 1 round. So basically, I think Vladimir asked me this question, right? How do I know what are the maximum numbers of loop that this entire k-means needs to go through yesterday, right? And then I said that until your centroid stops moving, right? In this case, I will be literally stopping my looping after 1 loop, and then see how it differs. Okay. Now let me open the code. So then just a second. Okay. I must have commented this. Let me remove the comment. Let me explain to you as to. This is, okay, let me start with, now, let me drag this a little bit. Now this is k-mean iris, and this is with 3 centroids, okay. This is with 3 centroids that I get 3 clusters here. You see, are you able to see this cluster? There are 3 clusters here. There are 3 clusters here. Let me explain you the diagram, and then I'll go back and explain you the problem. So there are 3 clusters here with k-mean iris equal to 3. There is no bar on the number of repetitions here. Okay, 1. This is with your KS8. Okay, and then the good thing here is that you can drag and drop in. You can just move around the cursor, and then you'll be able to see the cluster. So now if you see this here, you see There are 8 clusters here, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, I must have missed one, okay. So basically when you have 8 clusters, it becomes clumsy, it's not that very clear. Now, this one is with k equal to 3, but then you have stopped it with one repetition. Although it looks like, you know, k equal to 3 with n number of repetitions, it's just that in this case, there was no outliers or there was no lot of calculation, and hence it looks like this. But if you stop it at one repetition, most often than not, you will not be able to find out correct clustering. Okay, and then finally, the actual ground reality, the truth, which should be seen, and this is how it should look like. Setosa, Versicolor, and Virginica. Now let me go back and explain to you as to how each of this has been designed and calculated. Okay, so I've taken 3 random centers. Like I've explained to you, you know, if you remember k means problem, I just said, you know, just take 3 random numbers. So what I've done here is, I've taken 3 random centers. I'm loading the same iris data set that you already know of. I'm loading the target as well. And then now I have defined 3 clusters here where k means, this is again the class that which I need to call in my scikit-learn, right? You see here k means, like we saw decision tree algorithm, this is another algorithm k means here, where n cluster equal to 3. Your n cluster equal to 8, and in this case n cluster equal to 3, initialization parameter equal to 1, and then you have initialized the center at random, okay? But that's the output. So there's an iris dot target is output, iris dot data is the base, the primary data set, okay? Okay, cool. So after having done that, what I do is I just plot the figure. Basically, this plot dot figure would just give me the structure. Okay, it will just give me structure like this. Just a second. Okay, the plot dot figure will give me a structure like this. Okay, it'll give me 3-dimensional figure, and this is the safe end size. You can change the safe end size of the figure, and then inside that you're drawing this inside that figure. You know, you're just fitting a model X. X here is nothing but the dark data, right? And inside that you are plotting the graph for X3, which is the first 3 data sets, which is what's that called? Let me recall. Sepal length, sepal width, petal length, right? That's the first 3 data sets that you have taken here. Okay. And this is the output label. Basically, you are trying to draw a scattered graph. And if you remember from matplotlib, right, when you say scatter, it draws you a scattered plot. Okay, and then you are saying the type is of type float. The data that you are entering is of type float. Now, if there is something that you do not understand in some of these, it's just that basically, it's nothing, right? You're just trying to draw a scatter plot based on the data set that you are providing. You're providing 0 to 3rd column here, the 0th column here, and 0 to 2 column here, which is the input to the scatter plot, and this is of type float. Okay, based on that, what do you get? And then the rest is all drawing the labels, putting this value. I'll just take one example and then explain it to you. Okay, let me drag this. Now you see this here, petal width. This is the petal width because it's set at X level. The Y level is sepal length. The Z level here is the petal length. And you are drawing the X-axis, Y-axis, and Z-axis, you are putting these values, okay, using that tick labels. After having done that, you just plot the figure in this figure size that you have mentioned here, 4, 3, And that's about it. You know, similarly, you draw for setosa, versicolor, and virginica. Okay. These three, and you draw the graph again. So for each of those, k equal to 3, k equal to 8, k equal to, what was that? What was the other option? K equal to 3, k equal to 8, k and your, you have k equal to 3 and initialization parameter equal to 1. You draw this three graph initially, okay, 1, 2, and 3. Finally, we also have one more thing that we draw here. This is for the ground truth, okay. This is for the actual truth, wherein, let me explain you this now. Let me run this and then show you as to how the actual ground truth would look like. And after having done this, I'll go back to my slide wherein again I'll explain the same stuff, okay. So if you are not able to understand something right now, just hold on for 2 minutes. Oops, I closed it again. Let me run it again. Let me run this again. Okay, figure 4, right? Let me just concentrate on figure 4, okay? It's the same logic, okay? Figure 1 to 3 has the same logic. It's just that I'm putting that into a dictionary and then looping it. Figure 4 has a little different logic, and that's what I'm explaining. Now, for name and label in your whatever, setosa, versicolor, and virginica, setosa is represented by 0, versicolor by 1, virginica by 2, I am just taking a mean of that level, the data that you have provided, X label, right, the target data, I'm just taking a mean of that data, I'm just adding 1 for the center one, which is X level, X, Y equal to level 0, which is nothing but your setosa. For 2, I'm not taking anything. I'm not just putting 1. The reason I have this here is, okay, let me just run it and then show it to you. Now, if you see this, right, if you look at this diagram, setosa comes here, versicolor comes here, virginica comes here, okay. Now, let me run this with some other value. Okay. It's running. Now, if you look at this, right, it got changed, right? This setosa was appearing here, versicolor was appearing here, and virginica appearing here. So basically, in order to put a proper alignment of what I am trying to describe for that particular cluster, this is what I have done. Okay? And there is no one fixed rule to it. I've just taken a mean, or you can just put any numbers as well. So I just did a trial and error method, and I think at 1.5, it does not look that bad either at 1.5 as well. See here, even at 1.5, it does not look bad. It's clearly understandable that this is for setosa, versicolor, and virginica. While I do that, there are a couple of things that you need to understand. After having done that, you have given the horizontal alignment equal to center. These are parameters. Again, it will all be grouped in as a horizontal alignment at center, and you're also drawing this box with alpha point, edge color equal to B, face color equal to white, and so on and so forth, right? Basically, you're trying to format the output, and then you're drawing this scatter graph again, which is as same as the first one, okay? Here in your scatter graph, you're constructing an array from an already available indexed array Y, passed on the below scatter plot, okay? And this is for your X input that you just get it from here. Now, if there is something that we don't understand, right? Let's do one thing. Let's say we do not understand anything, okay? Let me do one thing. Let me print these values and then explain it to you. Okay? Just give me a second, okay? Let me pull this data and then explain to you. Okay, let me run it. Now let's not look at the graph, let's just look at the data. Now, if you look at this data, right? If I say x of 3, actually it's becoming a little clumsy, so let me print one by one. So basically when I say x of 3, you know that this is a list, right? If you look at this data, this looks just like a list. When I print just x, when I just print x, this is the input data I'm trying to display, okay? Just for your understanding. When I just pull the x value, right? X has got sepal length, sepal width, petal length, and petal width, right? When I say x of 0 to 3, it will just get me all these three values all the way from here to whatever is existing. And then you see this. Okay, so that's x of 3. You know, in a particular list, let me open an idle just to explain it to you a step further. Okay, let me define L1 equal to 1, 2, 3, 4. Okay, if I say L1 of okay, you see this? When I say L1 of colon 3, I get 1, 2, 3. That means I'm just using the three features which is available. Now, why am I doing that? I'm just doing that because I just want the first three features, okay, to be passed on to the data set. I mean, that's a different question altogether. But here, you know, the data that I'm passing, I'm just passing the first three feature set, the zeroth feature again, and the second feature, 0 to 2 feature. This is in order to draw a scatter plot, right? It needs data first. You need to pass everything and then you need to slice the data so that you get the coordinates of where you want to plot it. Okay, so basically first you have passed all the data and second you have sliced the data into two different halves. And finally, you pass the output level. What is y? Y is nothing but your output level. Oh, because I gave it, you see, I gave comma here. So that Puneet, do you see that? List integer must be integers, not tuple. It's giving me a type error because I gave in comma. Okay, so that's how I get this complete diagram. Okay, now let me go ahead and explain it here. Now it's the same thing that I've been explaining. It's the same cluster. So basically, if you understand here, right, this is n equal to cluster with 3. This is cluster with 8. It's not very clear here. Actually, it got interchanged. Okay, this should have been n equal to 3 and this should have been n equal to 8, but regardless of that, you understand what the problem is. And this is again n equal to 3, or your n cluster equal to 3 and initialization parameter equal to 1, which looks very much similar to this, but it is actually not the case in real life scenarios. And finally, this is the proper graph that we have drawn, which is called the ground truth, and you know, this is actually what should be the data. Now, you'll have to be very, you'll have to be able to judge as to how many number of iterations that's needed. And if you know that, well and good. Otherwise, the best suggestion would be to leave it as it is so that the algorithm is able to decide for you as to how many iterations it needs. And based on my explanation yesterday, right, the number of iterations should be as much as, you know, until the centroid stops moving. So that's the number of iterations that you need. So now moving on, right, that was an example of an iris flower set. So it looks a little complicated, whatever example that I've given, but don't worry, this is all 4 lines of code. Everything else is just formatting, okay? It's just 4 lines of code and everything else is just formatting. And if you, let's say for example, scatter plot, right? I'm trying to draw a scatter plot and then I'm passing so many parameters. If you don't understand this, all I would request you guys to go ahead and look into the structure of what scatter plot is. Basically, it's already defined function, right? You need to pass the parameters that it needs. And if you go ahead and read the, what is the, if you read the documentation of scatterplot, it will tell you, first pass me all the data, right? Second is, what is it that you want as an X label? The third parameter is, what is it that you want as Y label? And the fourth is, pass me all the target value. So that is what the documentation will give you. And based on that, you'll have to set all the data, okay? Now, there is, so basically, this is something that I'm just going to describe. There's no program for it that we have written here. So in case of your face recognition program, right, I think this also, this does not come as a default package. You'll have to get it from somewhere. You have to get the database of photos. So basically, if I were to write a program to do a facial recognition, right, you can also, if you have seen in Google, right, have you ever tried uploading a photo and do a photo search? If you have not done it, just go ahead and do it, okay? I mean, if you are searching for yourself, your result might not come as accurate. But if you are searching for famous personalities, you might just be accurate, okay? So if you are, let's say for example, if you are trying to search for George W. Bush, right, and wherein you would need to have database of all different types of George W. Bush. So basically, there are databases available for all famous personalities wherein there will be a lot of photos. So based on the photo that you provide and based on the nature of expressions, the darkness, the color, the expression, so on and so forth, you know, you'll be able to almost accurately predict whether that particular person is George W. Bush or not, if you have a photo. So basically, let's say, for example, I want to have an image search program, okay, on facial recognition. So for that, I need the various expression and all different types of photos that that is available for that particular person. It sometimes gives you wrong suggestion as well. It's little difficult, yes. So it's not that simple, right? Maybe I don't know, NASA would have some program in order to find accurate faces. But otherwise, even Facebook or even Google, they don't give you very accurate results. In Facebook, you have seen that, you know, do you want to tag this person at so-and-so, and sometimes it does not turn out to be that person. So basically, all Facebook needs is a complete database of that person's profile, okay? Or for example, let's say you or me, right? If Facebook has all the expressions of you and me, it will be able to analyze each of my pictures. It will be able to you know, find out each pixels. Let's say, for example, in this case, right? Let's say this is some pixel data, right? It will be able to find out the color of each of these pixels, your face, how your nose looks like based on the color, based on the texture, based on so many other features, right? There can be hundreds of features in each of these photos. They'll be able to analyze each of this and store the data. So the next time you pass similar photo, it'll be able to accurately search for that particular person and give you results. So you can go ahead and try this out, right, yourself. We have not given any code for this, basically, but then we are just explaining as to how facial recognition is done. See, there are eigenfaces is the name given to a set of eigenvectors when they are used in computer vision programs of human face recognition. So you see this, for each of these photos, right, your eigenface will be different texture. If you look at this, this is just black and white, and then it just has the structure of a face. This is a little different with a darker shade. You know, all of this at the end would translate into different pixels, right? And all of this, each of these photos is taken at this level, right? One photo can have hundreds of eigenfaces, okay? And so all these eigenfaces will translate into different pixels, the data would be stored, the algorithm would be trained, and based on that, you know, you'll be able to accurately predict whether or not I mean, not always accurately predict, but you'll be able to predict whether or not the photos that you have given can, you know, can be found out. I mean, the person can be found out with the photos that you have uploaded. So basically, a set of eigenfaces can be generated by performing a mathematical process called principal component analysis. So you know, this is the way to calculate your PCA. Based on this, you can find a set of photos from a given photo. Okay. Based on that, you know, you'll be almost be able to accurately predict all those famous personalities data. Now, on that note, I would want to give you a few more information on the precision recall, F beta store, F beta score, and support as to what each of this means while you are writing a face recognition program. I would suggest that you do not attempt this until you are comfortable with some of the basic programs like random forest, k-mean, knn, and the PCAs, etc. Right? So after you have done that, this would be one of your in an advanced project, but let me explain to you as to what a precision means in all of this. A precision is the ratio of your TP by, you just look at this formula, okay, TP by TP plus FP, where TP is the number of true positives and FP is number of false positives. Now, what do you mean by true positives? Okay, let me take an example. I mean, and you have to just extrapolate this to face, okay. I'll give you an example of your when you go to an airport, right, you have this metal detector, right? Not just airport, I think these days metal detectors are just about everywhere. So many a times it so happens that you might be carrying keys, which is metal, right? But, and then as soon as you go inside that metal detector, it starts beeping as if you are carrying a gun. But the task of your metal detector is not to detect a trivial thing such as keys, right? Its task is to detect if you are carrying a gun or not. That's the reason why the whole you know, metal detector was built. But let's say, for example, you pass through a metal detector and then even with a key, and then it does not give any warning. So that's a true positive. You just go through it. You're not carrying a gun or you're not carrying any weapon. You go through it and then it does not give you alarm, which is true positive. So it does what you are intended to do. Now, what's false positive? False positive is something, let's say you are carrying a metals, and then you go inside a metal detector, which is not a gun, and then it still gives you, you know, it starts beeping. It's giving a positive alarm, but then it's not actually, you're not actually carrying a weapon. So that's a false alarm, right? Which is false negative, false positive. Okay, recall and precision is calculated by true positive divided by true positive plus false positive. So that's how we calculate precision. The recall is the number of true positive by true positive plus false negative, where true positive is number of true positives and false negative is number of false negative. So when we say false negative, right, which is you carry a gun and then you go inside and it still does not beep. Right, that's a false negative. It's first of all, it's supposed to catch. So recall is the number of true positive by true positive plus false negative, wherein false negative is something, you go inside a metal detector and then it still does not with a weapon, and it still does not detect that you are carrying a you know, weapon. So that's a false negative. Now all of these are used in order to find your face recognition. Okay, all of these measures, right, all of these measures like precision, recall, etc., are used in order to decide the accuracy of whether your algorithm is able to correctly predict a particular face, a particular picture, etc. So that's about precision and recall. The F beta store can be interpreted as a weighted harmonic mean of the precision and recall. It's a mean of your precision and recall, where the F beta score reaches its best value at 1 and worst score at 0. So basically, your F beta score of 1 means it's able to accurately predict, whereas 0, it never predicts accurately. The support is the number of occurrence of each class in Y2. Okay, don't worry about this, you know. Just remember this precision recall and F beta score. This is majorly, all these measurements are majorly used when you are designing this kind of algorithm.